Gracious and loving God, we give thanks that you hold the whole world in your arms of love and grace. Amen. Please be seated. From the first moment that I arrived at St. Columba's last summer, I loved this image of Jesus over the altar, but I never really paid close attention to it until this last Thursday, which is in the church's calendar during Easter season, the Feast of the Ascension of Jesus. Next Sunday, we will finalize this interregnum between the Feast of the Ascension and Pentecost, the giving of the Holy Spirit to the church to continue the work on behalf of Jesus that Jesus is praying about in our gospel. So on Thursday, as I came for the Eucharist, I came early, and for the first time I realized that this is an image, a wooden carving of the ascending Jesus. So perhaps you are already all aware of this, but if you're not, I'd like to take just a few moments to take a look at it and sort of take a look at what it means to us, what it invites for us this morning to consider as we observe the ascension of Jesus. So I'm going to turn to look at it so that we can look at it together. Normally what is over the altar is either an empty cross, the sign of resurrection, or a crucifixion, or like in the chapel, Jesus robed in garments. This is, in the artist's imagination, what the ascending Jesus looked like. So what do we notice? First of all, Jesus' face is expressionless. You might say it has intention. Jesus is not looking at us. Jesus is looking down, not looking up, but looking down below to the world as he is ascending. Jesus' arms are outstretched. Is this the sign, as in the Jewish tradition, of prayer? Or is it the sign of blessing? Or is it the sign that God embraces the entire world? Then if you notice, around Jesus' waist is something that wraps around his lower torso. And as we just heard from the Acts of the Apostles, Jesus ascended through the clouds. So I imagine the artist has given us the image of Jesus slipping through the clouds towards heaven. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, I'm sorry you may not be able to see this if you've not seen it before, but there are the wounds in Jesus' body. You may not see it, but in the lower left rib cage, there is a scar where the spear slipped through his rib cage. And then on each of his feet are the signs of the wounds where the nails were hammered through his feet. So what does this mean for us today? The church's catechism asks us this question. What do we mean when we say that Jesus ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God? The catechism answers, we mean that Jesus took our human nature into heaven, where he now reigns with the Father and intercedes for us. So often we are focused on the divinity of Jesus and the signs that he did. This image reminds us that Jesus was fully human, His death was not a spiritual death. It was real. And so that reality of Jesus' humanity reminds us that all of the world is carried in Jesus. All that is good, all that is graceful, all that is blessing, but also all that is difficult and hard and painful and suffering. It's all carried in the body of Jesus into heaven. Jesus took our humanity, and I would add, all of creation. So now we are pivoting towards Pentecost. Pentecost reminds us at its heart that the Holy Spirit is given to the church to empower the church to be the body of Christ in the world today. It is not as if God's compassion is removed from the world with the ascension of Jesus, but we are called and we are empowered century after century to be the church. As Saint Teresa reminds us, we are the feet of Jesus. We are the hands of Jesus. We are the heart of Jesus. The same Jesus who ministered and promised the early church that they would not be left alone is the same Jesus who promises us the very same thing now. And that is what we will observe next Sunday with the Feast of Pentecost. I can't think of a more universally recognized symbol of what the hands, the feet, and the heart of Jesus looks like than Mother Teresa of Calcutta. There is no one known globally around the world who more embodied the compassion, the love, the mercy, and care for those who are hurting and lost, who are poor, and those who are dying on the streets. And her communities around the world continue and embody that life and that ministry. Here are some things that Mother Teresa reminds us about our ongoing work. The greatest disease in the world, in the West today, is not tuberculosis or leprosy. It is being unwanted, unloved, and uncared for. We can cure physical diseases with medicine. We can care for the marginalized, and we know how critical that is for the gospel. But the only cure for loneliness, despair, and hopelessness is love. There are many in the world who are dying for a piece of bread, but there are more, many more dying for a little love. The poverty in the West is a different kind of poverty. It is not only a poverty of loneliness, but also of spirituality. There's a hunger for love as there is a hunger for God. Quite simply, for me, and I imagine for you, this deep hunger is what draws us Sunday after Sunday to this place, where we are reminded of God's great love for us, and we are filled and restored to continue the work of God's love and mercy in the world, as Mother Teresa has given us an example. And here are final words from her that I'm going to quote. As she reflects upon serving the poor, housing the poor, creating leper colonies, feeding the hungry, she says, "What a trust it is for God to place suffering people in our hands. It is a sacred vocation for us all, sacred because each of them is a life from God, that has created in God's own image. Today, in this world, God has made us to be His love, His compassion. We become His love as we pray and as we come to see His face in the lonely eyes of others. Fellowship, prayer, works of compassion and mercy are an expression of this God-given dignity that has been given to all of humankind. We are called to receive the gifts and blessings of our own lives, but then entrusted into our hands through the power of the Holy Spirit is going back out into the world, like Mother Teresa, to care for those who are lonely, to care for those who are lost, to care for those that are hungry, and to care for those who are unhoused. We may not be Mother Teresa's ourselves, but she can be our compass, as Jesus was her compass. Amen.